So hi, everyone. My name is Rand. I'm the CEO at Zama, here with my co-founder, Pascal Payet. We've been running this meetup for about a year on a monthly basis. The idea is to present the state of the art in homomorphic encryption, ranging from hardware acceleration to cryptography to compilation and any other topic that is relevant to making this a real-time practical technology. So this is a very friendly meetup. You know, there is nothing formal about it. It's really just the people presenting the interesting work they've been doing. So today we have Florent, who's from Optalysis, who's going to be talking about optical computing and how this enables accelerating FHE. So I think, you know, it's going to be a very interesting talk, very technical as well. I hope you guys are ready for that. But I know that in general, if you're attending this meetup, is that you'd like to get into the details of how the technology actually works. I mean, I know I do personally. And of course, you know, you can join our Discord. If you go to fhe.org, we've got a Discord server now where we can continue the conversation. Florent is quite active there as well. You can ask questions about anything you want. It's not specific to Zama. It's just a general community Discord. So feel free to join there and then continue the conversation. So thank you very much, everyone. Florent, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Florent. So let me share my screen. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay, thank you. So thank you all for attending this call, this talk, and thanks a lot to the whole FHE.org team for giving me the opportunity to talk here. It's a real pleasure to be able to present the work that we are doing at Optalysis, where we aim to, in a few words, accelerate FHE, quite literally, to the speed of light. So to say a few words about who we are, so we are a small 11 people R&D company located in the north of England. So for those of you who are a bit familiar with the UK geography, we are situated in West Yorkshire, not far from Leeds. This is the red dot on the map here. And so of course, what I can say in 1 hour can only scratch the surface on what we are doing, both in the encryption space as well as on other topics. But if you are interested and would like more information, please feel free to have a look at our website, optalysis.com, and our Medium page, where you will find our many articles, which give much more details on what we are doing on encryption, artificial intelligence, computational fluid dynamics, and other topics which involve Fourier transforms. So also I am the only one to talk here today. What I will present is, of course, a collective effort by the whole Optalysis team, in particular, our CEO, Nick New, as well as my colleagues, Joseph Wilson and Edward Cotter, has contributed a lot to what I will present today. And I think Joseph, Edward, Nick, and Timon are in the chat and may answer some of your questions, if you have questions during the talk. So yeah, so to say a few words about what we do, so I will of course go into more details later in the talk, but to make a long story very short, we use an optical approach to computations with two related aims. So the first one is to accelerate the calculation of Fourier transforms, as well as all Fourier-based computations, such as convolutions, which occur a lot in artificial intelligence, and polynomial multiplications, which, as you probably know, also occur a lot in lattice-based cryptography. So another aim, which is related to the first one, is to reduce the energy cost of computing Fourier transforms, and therefore reduce energy cost of, for instance, running AI models which rely on Fourier transforms, or the cost to perform numerical simulations of physical systems using spectral methods, or the energy cost of implementing encryption schemes. So, so this is the product that we are currently developing. So this is an optical Fourier transform chiplet called the E-Tile. So I don't know if everyone is familiar with the terminology, but roughly speaking, a chiplet is a component which does not work individually, but which can be put on a chip to then fit into a computer. So this E-tile will perform natively a fixed size Fourier transform using optics. So this is why you have a prism with a lens here on top of the chiplet. So again, I will give more detailed specs later in the talk, but just to highlight the main figure. So we target for the first product to be able to provide an approximately 200 times efficient reboost over the current state of the art for commercially available hardware, which is the NVIDIA A100 GPU. So here by efficiency, speed normalized by power usage. And one important point that I should stress right away is that this 200 times is actually not limited by the optics, nor by the silicon photonics parts that we use in the chiplet. Both the optics and the silicon photonics part, essentially the whole chiplet, can run much faster. But we will be limited by the electronic interface, because of course, although this is an optical chip, we want it to be able to work with traditional electronic hardware, and therefore we have to convert information back and forth between the electronic and optical domains. And at least for a first product, this is what will limit us to this 200 times efficiency boost. So in principle, any improvement that we can make to this interface will lead to larger number here. So in principle, this ETAL, as I will explain in more details in the next slides, can accelerate all kinds of Fourier transforms. And as such, it has many applications in domains which use Fourier transform. So to cite a few of them, there's of course artificial intelligence, where Fourier transforms are used in convolutional neural networks, as well as in more recent convolutional transformers or FNets. It can also be very useful in digital signal processing, where Fourier transform is used for modulation, demodulation, as well as signal filtering. It's useful for solving partial differential equations, if you use a spectral method where the Fourier transform is a bottleneck. And that will be the core of my talk today, it can of course be very useful in lattice-based cryptography, which makes heavy use of polynomial multiplications, which for many of them can be accelerated using the Fourier transform. So I guess most of you are already familiar with free homomorphic encryption, but just to make sure we are all on the same page, let me give a very quick high-level introduction to FHE. So essentially, the problem that FHE solved is the following. So in the current state, or rather in the pre-homomorphic encryption state of things, data can be encrypted when at rest, this is when it is stored on hard drive or SSD or whatever, or when it is in transit, this is when it is exchanged between either two users or the user and the server or two servers. However, before FHE, we could not keep the data encrypted when actually used. This is when you want to analyze data or perform some computations using the data. You need to decrypt the data. And therefore, first, you run the risk that data can be stolen while you are doing computations on it. And you need to have absolute trust in the hardware that you do the computation on, since the hardware will have access to the decrypted data. And so, for instance, if you work with secret or private data, you may not be able to do any computation in the cloud, because this would involve the cloud server having access to this secret or private data at some point. Fortunately, with fully homomorphic encryption, or more generally with homomorphic encryption, we can now do such computations in the cloud, because the main point of fully homomorphic encryption is that it allows you to perform computations on encrypted data without having to decrypt it first. And therefore, data can be fully encrypted at all stages from just after it is collected to just before you read the final result. So yes, very quickly, I used homomorphic encryption and fully homomorphic encryption are somewhat interchangeably in the previous slide. Of course, they're not completely equivalent. And to be more precise, there are four different types of homomorphic encryption, which are partially homomorphic encryption and somewhat level and fully homomorphic encryption. So again, to make a very long story very short, in partially homomorphic encryption, you typically implement only one of the two fundamental operations, addition or multiplications on encrypted data. So these schemes are typically quite fast, but are also quite limited in what they can actually do. And somewhat homomorphic schemes allow you to do, in principle, any computation, but with a strong limitation on the circuit depth. So roughly speaking, can do any kind of computation, but the computation needs to be simple enough. With revert homomorphic encryption, you still have a limit on the circuit depth, but it is typically much larger, and it can be tuned by carefully choosing the parameters, so that if you know the maximum circuit depth in advance, you can always choose parameters such that you will be able to perform the computations. And finally, fully homomorphic encryption gets rid of the limit on the circuit depth altogether, that once you encrypt data using FHE, you can do any computation on it while still keeping it encrypted, or however complicated or however intensive the calculation is. So from this, and if we take for a moment the point of view of someone who does not know the limitations and current problems of FHE, it may be surprising that the field has not already taken off and that FHE is not already ubiquitous, since given how important data is in our modern society and given how important cloud computing is becoming, it would seem that all companies working with data would already have adopted FHE to be able to keep their data encrypted at all times. So this is unfortunately not yet the case, although it may well be in the near future. And as far as I can see, there are essentially three main reasons for that. So the first reason is that FHE is still a fairly new field of cryptography. So the first FHE scheme was found by Craig Gentry in 2009. So about 12 years ago now, which is a relatively short time for cryptography. And moreover, FHE also requires slightly different point of view on algorithms, since for instance, it is not straightforward to have branching algorithms in a fully homomorphic encryption schemes. And one consequence of this, that it's not yet always completely straightforward to convert code or workflows which work on which do not currently use FHE to work with FHE. And another consequence is that domain knowledge is still required to some extent to select suitable security parameters to ensure that the scheme is secure without having too large a runtime at the end. But fortunately, this is a problem which is already well on its way to being solved thanks to our recent libraries. So I can say, for instance, the Concrete library and its cousin Concrete Boolean, both developed by Xamarin. There is the Google's FHE transpiler developed by the Google FHE team, which can transpile C++ code into C++ code, which does not use FHE, into code which works with FHE. So we had a very nice meetup about this a few months ago, which you can find the FHE.org website. And there are the Helib, Seal, and Palisade libraries developed by NYU, IBM, Microsoft, and Duality, among others, which each in its own way makes working with specific schemes much easier than it was before. So essentially, also the fact that FHE is new is still an issue. And when we have discussions with companies which may benefit from using FHE, they always tell us that they are very interested in it, but that they don't yet have the expertise to use it or to see or to quantify the benefit it will bring. This is a problem which is already well on its way to being solved, and hopefully, thanks to these new libraries, FHE will be much easier to work with in the next few. It is already much easier to work with, and we can expect that everyone will find it easy to work with in the next few months or years. So a second issue which sometimes arises is the reliance on most FHE schemes on a particular set of mathematical problems, which are lattice problems, for their security. So in particular, most, or as far as I know, all of the main FHE schemes are currently based on the learning with error problem or one of its string variants. So in particular, both the BGV, PFV, ZKKS, JSW, and TFHE are based on some variant of the learning with error problem. And this is a contrast with a standard symmetric or asymmetric cryptography, where you have schemes based on fundamentally different classes of mathematical problems, such as our NTRU, for instance, which is also based on lattice problems, but also elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman, which, as its name indicates, is based on elliptic curves. You have schemes based on factorization of large numbers, such as RSA, and you have code-based schemes like Michaelis, which is also post-quantum secure. So this over-reliance on lattice problems is sometimes pointed out as one possible weakness of our current FHE schemes. However, I should also say that currently no efficient attack, neither classical nor quantum, is known against either the LWE problem or its ring variance. And therefore, although this may be this reliance on lattice problems may be maybe seen as a problem at an academic level, from a practical point of view, it does not seem to be an actual security issue. And finally, the third and probably by far the biggest issue to wide, the biggest barrier to wide adoption of FHE is its speed, since homomorphic operations on encrypted data are often much slower, so typically between 10 times and 1 million times slower than their plaintext counterparts. So there are different reasons for this. One reason is that ciphertexts tend to be significantly larger than the data they encode. There is the fact that the basic operations are typically a bit more complex than the plaintext ones. And most importantly, there is the need to bootstrap. So again, as you probably all know, in order for an FHE scheme to be secure, you need to encrypt data in a non-deterministic way. This need to introduce noise during the encryption process. Now, this noise will grow each time you perform computations, each time you perform an elementary operation on the ciphertext. And if you want to still be able to decrypt the result correctly, you need to keep the noise below a certain level, which means that at some point, you will need to reduce the noise level. So this is called the bootstrapping, and this is typically quite slow, or at least much slower than an elementary operation. So to speak a bit about the current solutions or tentative solutions to this problem. So first, there are a few software and hardware solutions which are already emerging. So one possibility is to try to eliminate bootstrapping altogether, as is done in somewhat or leveled homomorphic encryption. Although the drawback of this approach is that you are now limited in the kind of computations that you can actually do on the encrypted data. You can also try to keep bootstrapping, but reduce the number of bootstraps that you need to make for a given calculation, using other techniques such as modular switching to reduce the noise amplitude, as is done in the BGV and BAV schemes. Or you can also try to accelerate bootstrapping, which is the approach taken by TFHE. And the fourth approach, which has also been granted, as far as I'm aware, only in TFHE so far, and it is not, I think, the original TFHE library, but it is implemented in the concrete library developed by Zama. It's called programmable bootstrapping. Essentially, the idea is to use bootstrapping itself to perform computations. So, more precisely, you can evaluate any sufficiently smooth univariate function during the bootstrapping, while this evaluation would require a lot of bootstrapping stages without programmable bootstrapping. So, and there are also hardware solutions which are maybe a bit newer but already emerging. So one idea which is floating around is to introduce specific SIMD instructions, single instruction multiple data, which will be tuned to the kind of data that we work with in FHE. You can also implement FHE schemes on GPUs or FPGAs to use hardware acceleration. You can try to add native support for larger words, which I think is the approach taken by the DeepRive project of DARPA. So if you're interested in this, we had also a very interesting meetup last month on it, which I think is on the FHE.org website. And finally, we can try to build dedicated accelerators for the Fourier transform or its cousin, the number theoretic transform. And as you have probably guessed from my introduction, this is what I will focus on for the remainder of this talk. So yes, let me now dive into the core topic and show how we can accelerate FHE using Fourier optics. So, but first, let me comment a little bit on why we would like to accelerate the Fourier transform or the number theoretic transform in the first place. Well, essentially, the point is that ring learning with our schemes make heavy use of polynomials. So typically, ciphers are, depending on the schemes, they can be either polynomials or either parts of or vector of polynomials. But in all cases, you have a lot of polynomials involved. And when you work with polynomials, you have essentially two basic operations. So you have polynomial additions, which are quote unquote fast, or more precisely, they have an O(n) complexity, where n is the degree of the polynomial. And you have polynomial multiplication, which is typically much slower and which has at best a complexity in O(n) log n. And the good news for people like us who are developing a Fourier transform accelerator is that in the most efficient algorithm for polynomial multiplication, the Fourier transform is typically the main bottleneck in the calculation. So here, this is illustrated on this graph, where I show the fraction of the number of elementary operations which are due to the Fourier transform as a function of the polynomial size n. So I will give more details on how this is computed in the next slides. But as we can already see, for polynomial sizes which are larger than, say, 512, as is usually the case in FHE schemes, the fraction of the Fourier transform in polynomial multiplications is typically between about 85% and 95% of the calculation. So essentially, if you can accelerate the Fourier transform or the entity for schemes which support it, you can accelerate a fraction of the calculation, which typically accounts for more than 80% of the total runtime. So unfortunately, the Fourier transform is not that straightforward to accelerate, or at least not on standard electronic hardware. There are two main reasons for this. The first one is that the most efficient algorithms cannot be fully parallelized because they involve several steps and each step requires data computed at the previous step. So even if you parallelize everything, even if you had a huge device with enough score to do all the operations you can in parallel, you will still be limited to runtime in omega of log n, where here radix is the size of the small Fourier transforms that you use in the algorithm. And another reason is that these algorithms have some steps which are called the butterflies, and which essentially consist in a lot of memory accesses. And moreover, memory cannot, at least not trivially, be accessed in a continuous way. And this can slow down the algorithm significantly on top of the limitation on the runtime and on the ability to parallelize them. So, So to give a point of comparison for what we'll talk about later, currently the state of the art for commercially off the shelf available hardware is the NVIDIA A100 GPU, which has a TDP of about 400 watts. So this is just for the GPU without the electronics around it, which is needed for the I/O interface. And it can achieve 4 powers of 2 Fourier transform, that is in the best case, between 4 and 5 teraoperations per second. And the question is, how can we go beyond that? Because if we want to accelerate FHE by orders of magnitude, we will need to perform the Fourier transforms much, much, much faster than the NVIDIA A100 GPU can. And this is very difficult on standard electronic hardware. So this solution that we propose at Optalysis is, instead of using electronic hardware, which does not seem to be very well suited for the Fourier transform, instead, let us use a different physical process, which will naturally perform the Fourier transform, quote unquote, for free, by which I mean without us having to do any work on the system to do the computation. Unfortunately, such a physical process exists, and this is one we are all familiar with to some extent, since this is just propagation of light. So this is illustrated very schematically on this slide. Again, the idea is to use the process of wave interference to perform computations without us having to do any active work on it. So here, yes, these diagrams are meant to illustrate in a very sketchy and hand-waving way why it is so, why propagation of light can compute Fourier transform. So essentially, there are two elements. One element is the linearity. In fact, if you have two light sources, the state of the electromagnetic field that you get is just the sum of the amplitude of the electromagnetic field that you get is just the sum of the amplitude produced by each point source. And the second one is that light propagates isotropically, at least in an isotropic medium. That is, if you have a point source, which could be described mathematically by delta H function, light will propagate at the same speed and the same way in all directions, so that the wavefronts, that is the loci, where the phase of the field is the same, will be circles, or more precisely, will be spheres in three dimensions. And the point is, if you look very far from the emission point, now the light rays will look nearly parallel, and the wavefronts will look very close to being straight lines or to being planes in 3D, which from a slightly more mathematical perspective means that light propagation converts a delta function, this is a point light source which emits light somewhere, into a plane wave. This is something which very far away from the point of emission will look like a plane wave, which is just a wave which has a plane wave forms, this name indicates. So, yes, well, of course, the way I explained it is quite unwavy, but you can actually show rigorously that by combining these two properties, linearity and the fact that the delta function is converted to a plane wave and conversely, that yes, propagation of light over a large distance will perform the Fourier transform. And the beauty of it is that you don't need to actively do any work. So, in principle, you have no energy dissipation at all. So it seems that we are close to our goal. We now have a physical system which naturally and automatically performs the Fourier transform. Here we just have a small problem, which is that for the approximation to be good, you need the two planes, so the emission plane and the plane where you detect light, to be very far away from each other. And of course, we don't want that for a chip, because we want the chip to be as small as possible. And therefore, we want the distance between the emission plane and the reception plane to be also as small as possible. Fortunately, this is possible using a lens. So again, I will not go into all the details of light propagation. It could easily take a full 1 hour talk. But to make a long story short, if you had a lens, either a spherical or plane spherical lens, as represented here, you can show that an incident plane wave on the lens will be converted to a point source at a fixed distance f from the lens called the focal lens. And conversely, if you have a point source at the same distance on one side of the lens, it will produce a plane wave on the other side. So essentially, a lens allows you to do exactly what I showed in the previous slide, but instead of requiring a very large distance to have a good approximation to the Fourier transform, now you can do the same thing over a fixed distance of 2f, where f is the focal length of the lens. And yeah, so this has two main benefits over standard electronic Fourier transforms. First, as I mentioned, you don't have to actually do any work. So in principle, you have no energy dissipation at all, well, beyond this small reflection on the lens and maybe light which is lost if you don't capture everything on the other hand. But so the energy dissipation is very small. And the latency is also very small since, well, light is one of the fastest things in the universe. And so for instance, to give some numbers, if we take a lens with a focal length of 0.5 centimeters, the latency, which is just the distance that light has to travel divided by the speed of light, is about 0.033 nanoseconds, which, roughly speaking, converts to a frequency of about 30 gigahertz for a full Fourier transform, since you could have, in principle, an arbitrary number of points in the emitting plane. Okay, so we have seen that that using optics and using light allows us to perform Fourier transforms in principle much faster and using much less energy than electronic hardware can. Now let me say a few words on how this can be used for FHE. And to see this, let me first make a small detour by convolutions. So let us consider two complex arrays A and B with the same size n. So I define their convolution in this way. So for those of you who are familiar with convolutions in machine learning, this is very similar to what you are familiar with. The main difference with standard deep learning models that here I consider periodic convolutions. Well, you know, we use padding or other boundary conditions. And so you can show that this convolution is equivalent to polynomial multiplication in the ring Cx over x to the n minus 1, that is to polynomial multiplications modulo this polynomial x to the n minus 1. But also this formula is a good way to define the periodic convolution and can be useful to reason mathematically about it. It is actually not very useful if you want to actually compute the convolution, because as you can see, the complexity of this formula is quadratic in the number n of elements. So here in this sum, you have n elements, and for each element, you have one complex multiplication. And this is just to compute one element of the result. Since you also have n elements in the result, the total number of operations will be proportional to n squared. Fortunately, there is a much faster way to compute convolutions, at least for large values of n, which is to go through the Fourier transform. So here I show the definition of the discrete, direct, and inverse Fourier transforms. The precise formulas are not very important for the remainder of the talk. So if you are not into mathematical formulas, please feel free to forget them. What is important, however, that you can show that the convolution of two complex arrays A and B is given by this formula, is the inverse Fourier transform of the multiplications of the Fourier transform of A and B, where here, by multiplication, I mean a component-wise multiplication. So the first coefficient of F of A is multiplied by the first coefficient of F of B, the second coefficient of F of A is multiplied by the second coefficient of F of B, and so on. So here we have only n multiplications, not n squared. And each Fourier transform has a complexity O n log n if you use a fast Fourier transform algorithm to compute it. And therefore, now the total complexity of this formula is in theta of n log n rather than theta n squared, which for large values of n will be much, much faster. So you require much fewer elementary operations. So, yes, so to give me a better feel on the reductions can provide. On this diagram, I show the number of elementary operations required for the naive algorithm using the definition of the convolution in blue, and using an FFT algorithm in orange. So in green, you have the same curve, but for powers of two polynomial sizes. And as you can, so here by operation, I mean one real operation, but the graph would be approximately the same. Would not change much depending on the definition if you change the definition of an elementary operation. So the important point to notice is that for large polynomial sizes, so typically as long as the degree of the polynomial is above approximately 100, the number of operations needed for the algorithm using the Fourier transform is much smaller than the number of operations needed for the naive algorithm. So for instance, for polynomial degrees of about 10,000, you get difference of a factor between 100 and 300. So yes, so the orange curve here is predicted with an FFT algorithm of radix 2. So the number of operations can be further reduced if you can go to higher radixes and if you can perform the elementary Fourier transforms in O1 runtime, as becomes possible with the optical Fourier transform. So for instance, if you use radix 64 rather than radix 2, you get the green curve here, which is of course below the orange curve. And also the difference between the two may not seem very large. Notice that the vertical axis is logarithmic, so that actually that you have a factor 3 between the two, meaning that if you use a Fourier transform with radix 64, you get 3 times fewer elementary operations per convolution than if you use a Fourier transform of radix 2. And this is compounded, or this acceleration is compounded, with the fact that using the optical approach, we can make these operations much faster than the electronics. Okay, so we are close to our goal of showing why accelerating the Fourier transform is actually useful for FHE. There just remains one small problem, which is that so far we worked with polynomials or modulo polynomials of the form x to the n minus 1, which are unfortunately not those used in FHE. So if I understand correctly, the issue that they are factorizable in D of x, so you can always write x to the n minus 1 in this way. And so this can introduce potential for attacks on the scheme. But FHE schemes typically instead use a particular class of polynomials called cyclotomic polynomials. So I'm not going into the details of what cyclotomic polynomials are. Again, it would easily require a 1 hour presentation. But I will just mention one very nice property for us, which is that some of these polynomials, so more specifically the 2 to the k's cyclotomic polynomial, where k is any positive integer, has the form which is very close to this one. This is a form x to the power 2 to the k plus 1. And as you can see, if we set n equal to 2 to the k, the only difference between the two is that the minus sign is replaced by a plus sign. So the idea is to see whether what we showed above can be extended to the fact that we have a plus sign here. So polynomial multiplications with the minus sign were equivalent to periodic convolutions. Similarly, polynomial multiplications modulo x to the n plus 1, where n is an integer, are equivalent to anti-periodic convolutions. That is, in the formula for the convolution, you now have a minus sign in front of the terms where the index of B overflows. But apart from that, you have the same formula as for periodic convolutions. And in particular, if you use this naive formula, you again have a quadratic number of complex multiplications in the degree of the polynomial. But fortunately, as was the case with the minus sign, you can reformulate the antiperiodic convolution using the Fourier transform to reduce the algorithmic complexity. So it is just a little bit more complicated than the previous approach, but not too much. You just have to define one additional vector whose coefficients are given here. So essentially, it's just a vector of complex numbers with unit moduli. And then you can show, well, it's a fairly straightforward calculation, that the convolution with antiperiodic boundary conditions of Torres A and B is given by this formula, which is just a little bit more complicated than the previous one. But the important thing is that, again, it involves only component-wise multiplications, the complexity in theta of n, and direct or inverse discrete Fourier transforms with complexity in n log n. So the total complexity is, again, n log n, with the Fourier transforms having complexity n log n, while all the other operations have complexity in theta of n. So that for large values of n, the Fourier transforms become by far the main bottleneck and the bulk of the calculation. And so now we can go back to the graph I showed earlier and better understand why it behaves the way it does. That for large Fourier transforms, sorry, for large polynomial sizes, you have the Fourier transform, which has a complexity n log n, while all the other operations have complexity, have a linear complexity in n. And therefore, for large values of n, the number of operations required for the Fourier transform will be dominant over the other operations. And that is why the fraction of the operations needed for the Fourier transform goes to one in the limit where n goes to infinity. And practice is above 80% as soon as the degree of the polynomial is above a few hundreds. So essentially the main point to remember from all of what I've said above is that for the kind of polynomials which are used in the main FHT schemes, the Fourier transform or the number theoretic transform accounts for most of the calculations, for typically more than 80% of the polynomial multiplication. And so now let me give more details on how we at Optalysis will accelerate the kind of Fourier transforms used in FHT. So yes, as I briefly mentioned at the beginning of my talk, we are developing the ETEL chiplet, which uses light to compute fixed size Fourier transforms. So essentially, the way it works is so you have laser light, which is not represented here, which is split into n different input channels, where n is the size of the Fourier transform done by the ETEL. Then we can encode our complex information into the light using arrays of Mach Zehnder interferometers, after which light passes through the prism and the lens will compute the Fourier transform. And finally, the light is retrieved on the other side by photodiodes, either standard or balanced photodiodes, and converted back to electric signal, which can be sent to standard electronic hardware. Okay, so this ETEL will be just a chiplet, so we're going to be able to work independently. So that's why we are also developing the eChip, which is a fully fledged silicon chip, which will contain four ETELs. As four ETELs, we're able to do a full complex Fourier transform in each clock cycle. And it also contains all the driver circuits, memory, and I/O interface required to feed data to the ETELs and get the results from the ETELs. And finally, we're also developing a full board, which we call the EVO board, on which this chip will sit, which will be a fully integrated solution for both large Fourier transforms, as well as convolutions, polynomial multiplications. And the idea is essentially to be able to perform the full bootstrap operation on the board. And if you can send data to the board, perform the full bootstrap operations using the ETELs to perform the Fourier transforms and send data back only after it has been bootstrapped, you can get the maximum acceleration and efficiency boost for the bootstrap operations and therefore for the FHT workflow. Okay, so what I showed above are not photos, as are renders made by my colleague Joseph Wilson, because all of these is still in development. But to show that all of this is not just empty words, here is an actual photograph of our current work in progress system, which we already have in the lab here at Optalysis. Essentially, it uses the very same principle that the ETEL will use, that is data, our electronic data is encoded into light, which then passes through a prism and through a lens to the Fourier transform, and the result is then detected and converted back to electronic data. So the two main differences are that first, this demonstration system is significantly larger than the ETEL, so it is a few centimeters. It has a few centimeters of size, while the ETEL will be about one order of magnitude smaller. And it also uses slower thermal modulators working in the kilohertz range, while the ETEL will use much faster modulators, which can work to the gigahertz range. So I mentioned briefly that in electronic information is encoded into the light using Mach Zehnder interferometers. So let me briefly sketch how this works. So this is a sketch of one single input line where the black lines are optical waveguides. And yeah, so as you can see, essentially, a waveguide separates in two, then recombines, then separates in two again, and then recombines. So you can show that when a waveguide is split in two, at least in the ideal case, each arm of the interferometer will receive a fraction 1/√2 of the field amplitude. So you can show this square root of two is required for energy conservation. Then light passes through part of the waveguide whose optical index can be tuned. So in the current system, it can be tuned by changing the local temperature. And the idea is that when passing through this part, the electromagnetic field will acquire a phase, which depends on the optical index. And finally, at one of the two points where the arms recombine, the amplitude of the field after the combination will be the sum of the amplitude in each arm divided by square root of two. Again, you can show the square root of two is ensures energy conservation. So this, the top diagram is for just one input line. Now, if you have an array of input lines, as we have in our system and as we have on the tags, get something which very schematically looks like this. So essentially just an array of what is shown above. So we can shine laser light into the array. So we are, by convention, we say that the amplitude of the laser light is equal to one. Then it passes through the first Mach Zehnder interferometers. So up to the point where the waveguide first recombines, and by tuning the optical indices of each branches of each branch of each interferometer, we can encode an array of number of complex numbers x into the light at this point. Then light goes through a second array of interferometers, which we can use to multiply this array with another one, before being sent to the prism and the lens, which will compute the Fourier transform, and we then detect the result. So in the current system, we can only detect the squared amplitude of the electromagnetic field, and therefore what we get is the squared modulus of the Fourier transform. But we can either by using balanced photodiodes or by using several frames actually recover the whole complex output. So this was maybe a bit formal and a bit sketchy. So let me show how it will work in practice on the ETAL, on the render made by my colleague Joseph Wilson. So essentially, the ETAL has four main regions of interest. So the region one, shown in the top left render here, is where we will transfer the kind of IO region, if you want, where we transfer the digital information into the chiplet. Then this part is where the Mach Zehnder interferometers will be. This is where electronic information will be encoded into the light. So then, as I have explained, light will pass through the prism and the lens will perform the Fourier transform of the electromagnetic field. And finally, in the region four here, the amplitude of the electromagnetic field is retrieved using either standard or balanced photodiodes, converted back to an electronic signal, which can be sent out of the ETAL to the chip or to whatever device the ETAL is connected with. Okay, so I will maybe go quickly on this part. But yes, so those of you who are a bit familiar with optics may have noticed that with a spherical Fourier transform, what we perform is a two-dimensional Fourier transform and not a one-dimensional Fourier transform as is used in FHE or in one-dimensional convolutions. But fortunately, there are ways to convert a 2D Fourier transforms into one-dimensional Fourier transforms. So just a few words about it. We can use a slight modification of the Kulituki FST algorithm, just modifying the butterfly step and the two-dog factors to convert a set of 2D Fourier transforms into a set of batched 1D Fourier transforms without loss of efficiency. So if you want more details, I've published a Medium article about it a while ago. And similarly, although the ETAL will perform Fourier transforms of fixed size natively, we can use it to reconstruct Fourier transforms of arbitrary size using both the Kluge-Tucci FFT algorithm or any FFT algorithm to go to sizes which are powers of the native size of the tile, or combining it with the Bluestein algorithm to perform Fourier transforms which are not powers of the tile size. Okay, so before I conclude, let me show one small demo that we have made, essentially implementing a homomorphic version of Conwave Game of Life using the optical Fourier transform and Zama's concrete Boolean library. So to say a few words about the Game of Life, it is a simple two-dimensional cellular automaton on a square grid. Therefore, each cell has eight neighbors, and each cell can be in one of two states, either live or dead, with the following rules. So if a cell is alive with exactly two or exactly three live neighbors, it updates to live. If it is dead with exactly three live neighbors, it updates to live. And in another configuration, it updates to dead. So this can it lead configurations like this one? So this is called a glider. So here with periodic boundary conditions. So yes, one of the elements which make this interesting is that although it is a very simple cellular automaton, it is actually Turing complete. So this is due to two elements. So first, you have self-similar moving patterns, such as the glider they showed in this small animation, which move diagonally. And you also have slightly more complex structures called spaceships, which move either horizontally or vertically. And you can also have interactions between these moving patterns, which can replicate Boolean gates. So the idea is that either one glider or one spaceship can encode for one bit, and then the interactions can encode Boolean gates. So just to briefly give some examples of what you can do. So for instance, you can easily realize kind of proto not gate in this way. So if in the program region, you have a glider moving towards the top right, and the input region, you have either zero or one glider moving to the bottom right. Then, yes, if you have no input, the program glider just move to the output region, and so you get a one in the output. Well, if you have a glider in the input region, now the two gliders will collide, and therefore you will have a zero in the output region. So similarly, you can have an identity quote-unquote gate, which will reflect the glider, as shown in this short animation here. So if you have a one in the input region, it will be reflected, and so you get a one in the output region. While if you have a zero, this is if you have no glider in the input region, nothing will be reflected, and you get zero in the output. So you also have more slightly more complex patterns, such as glider guns, which periodically produce gliders. Shown here, as well as the regions called glider eaters, as shown in the bottom right here, which will annihilate any glider which collides with them. And so essentially, well, again, I will not go into the detail, to all the details, because it could easily cover the whole presentation. But you can show that by combining glider guns and glider eaters, you can realize both duplicators and non-gates, and therefore realize any circuit on gliders. So yeah, so why would we like to implement Game of Life homomorphically? Well, of course, that's not because the Game of Life states are secrets. There are no, well, at least I'm not aware of anyone encoding secret data into Game of Life states. However, we think they are very good. It is a very good benchmark tool. For three reasons. First, because it has two parameters which allow us to tune the circuit depth and the circuit width. Essentially, the board size will be proportional to the circuit width, while the number of updates will be proportional to the circuit depth. It's also easy to parallelize, since each cell can be updated independently, and it's easy to check that the result is correct. So yeah, so to implement it homomorphically, well, the idea is to first reformulate the rules as a Boolean circuit, then encrypt the initial state using an FHE scheme, then can update the board homomorphically for some number of epochs, and finally decrypt the result. So yes, maybe we skip the technical parts, running a bit short on time, and all the details are given in the Medium article if you're interested. Again, maybe just briefly show some code that we use. So again, we use a concrete Boolean library. So this is the code used to set and encrypt the initial state. So essentially, the main message from this slide that using concrete Boolean is very easy to do. As you can see, just a few lines of code are enough to both set the initial state and encrypt it. So this is the code used for decryption, which is also very simple, just a single call to a function where client key is the structure implementing the secret key. And this is the code used for the homomorphic update. So here we have a code which we have a small 3-bit adder, which will add one, which will add a cipher encrypting for either 0 or 1 to a 3-bit cipher encoded for a value between 0 and 7. From this, we can define a sum function which will sum an arbitrary number of ciphers, so which we'll use to sum the encrypted states of the neighbors of each cell. And we can now easily use that to check if a cell should be alive or dead as the next iteration by computing the sum of the states with neighbors, checking if it is 2 or 3, or if it is 3, and using a small Boolean circuit. So again, the main message from these slides is that using concrete Boolean, it is very easy and straightforward to implement all this. Actually, there is not much more code than if you wanted to implement it non-homomorphically. And yes, so to give estimates on what our device can provide, so we have done benchmarks both on a desktop computer using the Intel i7 and Intel i7 CPU with the FFTW3 library for different transforms. So this is within the standard concrete library. And we have also modified this library to use our optical Fray transform rather than the FFTW3 library for the Fray transforms. And using this modified library, we estimate that on the chip, each update would take approximately 0.8 seconds for a 6x6 board, while the same algorithm takes about 50 seconds on the Intel i7. So these numbers are power normalized. This will assume that we reduce the power of the chip to match the TDP of the, or to match the power used by the Intel i7 for this computation. So we get a speed up of about 60 for this problem. So we also did other demos, which you can find on our Medium webpage, where the speed up oscillates between 60 and 100. And essentially, we expect our similar parallel results. Again, either higher end CPUs, such as the Intel Xeon, or against GPUs, since when you power normalize, results are about the same for these different kinds of hardware. Okay, so to conclude, so we at Optalysis think that it is a very exciting time for fully homomorphic encryption. First, because as I briefly mentioned at the start of my talk, new libraries are making it really easier than ever to work with FHE, and in some cases, nearly as easy as to work with non-encrypted workflows. So here you have links to the libraries that I've mentioned. So the concrete library developed by Xama, the FHE transpiler developed by the Google FHE team, the Helib, Silk, and Palisade libraries. And there are also emerging hardware projects. So some of them are trying to build full dedicated processor architectures, such as teams involved in the DARPA Deprive projects. And others focusing on specific function accelerations, such as what we are doing or what Cornami is doing. And what we see as particularly exciting is that all these approaches are not really competing against each other, but on the contrary, can build on each other's successes. Since, for instance, you could imagine a full dedicated processor architecture we should also use specific function accelerators for the Fourier transform or for other function to compound the speedups brought by the different approaches. And all of this could also run an improved library to also make use of software accelerations, which will surely rise in the next few months and years. So yeah, so to wrap up on what we are doing at Optalysis, so the main products that we are developing is the ETILE, which is an optical Fourier transform chiplet, which so we target it working for the first iteration at a 1 GHz frequency and are doing about 2.1 teraoperations per joule, which would be 200 times more efficient than the state of the art. And this ETILE will go on a full board, which we call the EVO board, which will be a fully integrated solution for Fourier-based computations. And the idea being to be able to do the full bootstrap on this board to be able to provide the best, the optimal acceleration. And so to talk a bit about our roadmap. So with our first product, the chip, we are expect to have at least a 10 times speed up over state of the art over the full FHE workflow. So not just for polynomial multiplications, but for the whole end-to-end workflow. Once we get the EVO board, we expect this number increase to about 100 times. And as I mentioned, since our main limitation will be a conversion between electronic and optical data, we expect improvements to the digital analog interface and the possibility to have more than 4 ETILEs in parallel will lead to yet higher speedups, potentially more than 10,000 speedups. And of course, as I briefly mentioned, this can and will be compounded with speedups brought by other approaches, such as software improvements, algorithmic improvements, or full dedicated hardware architectures, so that we are quite confident that in the relatively near future, we can collectively, the FHE community, achieve a 1 million times speed up for FHE operation, and therefore make FHE genuinely real time. And yes, so again, what I said in this talk only cover a small fraction of what we are doing at Optalysis. And so yes, if you're interested, please have a look at our Medium page and at our website, which are shown here. And of course, please feel totally free to get in touch with us if you're interested and think we could collaborate on some project. And this, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Florent. This was really interesting. I learned definitely a lot of things, including stuff about Fourier transforms. So I think, you know, it's nice to see all that kind of content. Does anyone have any questions for Florent? If you have any questions, just unmute yourself and ask it directly. Please just mute yourself back after you're done. Thank you.
Hey, Florent. Bryant here. I absolutely love the talk. Great work. Back a few slides when you were talking about the chip design, I think we've talked about this in the past, but it's clear that the wavelength of the light and the distance is probably one of the hardest bits to talk about here because you're really constrained. But obviously the natural kind of extension here is multiplexing. Have you started thinking about that? Is that a deep trade secret or?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, I don't know exactly what I can talk about or not, since some of this is not publicly.
Fair enough.
But yes, absolutely. Multiplexing is absolutely something we have in mind. And yes, maybe you can talk more about it if you're interested in a non-public conversation.
Okay.
Or I should first check with my colleagues what I can reveal or not.
Thanks for the talk as well from my side. I don't know much about optical computing, so maybe I'm going in a totally wrong direction here. But usually we do the transforms over ZQ, right? So modulus some prime. How big are the numbers that are supported there with your chip?
That's a very good question. Yeah, that's particularly a good question since, in general, one of the difficulties with optical computing is to get high accuracy and therefore to work with large numbers. So fortunately, although our device will natively work with relatively low precision compared with standard electronic hardware, it is possible to build up the accuracy using several frames, essentially using the linearity of the Fourier transform or the bilinearity of polynomial multiplications, so that we can, at least in principle, go to arbitrary accuracy and therefore arbitrary large numbers.
And what is currently supported? Like, can you give like a bit count, maybe something like this?
Yes. So natively, as I think I can talk about this, natively, the ETAG will work with 10-bit complex numbers. But yes, since using the fact that the polynomial multiplications is bilinear, we can go to much higher. So yes, we plan to at least support 64-bit calculations, like 64-bit real calculations, that is 128-bit compressed calculations, in the first iteration, first after stack, and there is ample room to go much beyond that if needed.
Thanks so much. I'll just add a second question, if I may. So you also mentioned, right, like with the butterfly structure of the NTT and also kind of like the big polynomial degrees, there's also lots of limitations with memory. So
yes,
like, and you also mentioned that actually your chip is mostly like the speed is mostly limited by memory. So I'm just wondering if you would do you plan to address this with like maybe unified memory on your board, or like what's your idea to speed it up there? Because this is still like a big problem, right? Especially for high degrees.
Yeah, that's a very good question. That's also a point where I'm not sure exactly what I can say or not, but yes, we are definitely considering this question, and yes, we have ideas which are, again, I'm happy to discuss in more details in a non-public way. But essentially my answer would be two points. Yes, first, yes, we are absolutely aware of this and absolutely considering this discussion. And second, so yes, one thing which I can definitely say is that since the optical Fourier transform allows us to work with much larger radix, we reduce the number of memory accesses by a lot compared with standard electronic FFT algorithm, which typically use radix 2 or 4. So yes, essentially the memory, it will still be a problem, but it will be less of a problem for us than it is for standard hardware. And yes, we are definitely planning to address this problem.
All right, thanks.
Quick follow on. Kind of like astronomy, this seems like one of those problems where the bigger the thing, the better it gets. Is there just a garbage truck sized chip in the wing someday where we can do a million by a million transform, or what's the limiting reagent here?
That would be fantastic. a million by a million times sounds a bit difficult to me, but I mean, why not in the medium to long term? Now, in practice, one thing which becomes difficult when you go to large sizes is to maintain coherence between the different inputs. Yes, if we want the photon, essentially, if we need, essentially, we have a laser which is split into several input lines. Now, since we are essentially limited by the power of the laser and the minimum power that our detector needs on the other hand to detect. So yes, in practice, we are limited. Again, I don't know exactly if I can give precise numbers, but we are probably, given what we currently plan to do, we are probably limited to say a few hundreds in the typical size. Again, for the native Fourier transform done by the ETAL. Now, of course, using an FFT algorithm on top of that, we can go to arbitrary sizes. But yes, in the longer term, I can see no fundamental reason why we could not go to much larger sizes.
I see. So it sounds like, you know, there's like a fundamental, like there's a single beam splitter underneath that's going to be the kind of the primary signal generator. And that's the sort of the main limiting
Yes, that's at the moment how we work. Now, of course, there's no fundamental reason why we could not have different lasers or have ways to increase the power in one run.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other question? Okay, if there are no other questions, well, thank you very, very much. All this will be, of course, available at the FHE.org website. The talk is recorded. Florent also shared some links to their Medium blog post out of Thalysis, which I can say is very, very nice, very high quality content there, I have to say. And yeah. So looking forward to talking to you guys on the Discord channel. And if someone has something they'd like to present, let me know. I know that we have someone who's gonna be making an introduction on private information retrieval using FHE. That should be either in January or February. I know also that Aurel, who's working at Zama, will also be doing a talk about transciphering for FHE, which is another very important part. So let me know if you want to present something, and have a great end of week, guys.